guys in the front. I'm the short one. So my name's Philip. I'm the chief executive of Revivify Foundation. It's amazing to be here, and thank you all for joining me for this. I joined the foundation in July, and I said at the time it's more like joining a community than joining a company. And actually, the last two weeks, you've really felt that, and you can really feel it today. So thank you for making me feel so welcome. But I want to say some thanks before I start talking, really. I want to do a big shout out to Mike and Tim, if you know they're in the room. Can we do some whoop-whooping for Mike and Tim? They put in. I don't know if their wives or families are there, but I should say thank you to them as well. They invented the concept of the Raspberry Pi widow. I know there are Raspberry Pi widowers as well. We're going to start a spouse program, I think. I also want to give a shout out to Helen Drury, who sat in the back. She joined us in January, and like I said, oh yeah, can you just run a bet, which is like our biggest event of the year, and help out on the birthday, which is our most important event of the year. I'm sorry, it'll get easier, but big trustees are here. Hi, trustees. It's just an amazing effort. You're all awesome. I should say thank you as well to the Science Lab, who's hosting us again. Our partnership with the University of Cambridge is really important to us. So thank you, everyone. Thank you. I'm going to talk a little bit about what the foundation's been doing over the past year. Share a few thoughts on the future, and I'm probably going to try and get through this in less than half an hour, so that we can have a few questions. And since I joined in July, I spent a lot of time chatting to our trustees, to our members, to members of the community, to the staff, just trying to figure out what it is we're really about, right? How do we use our resources and capabilities to achieve our goal? What is our goal, and how do we know we're winning? So this is what we've published a new strategy, which we've developed with the trustees and lots of input from people. And we put it out in the world recently. We agreed in December, and it's there, and people have been commenting on it and giving us feedback, which is awesome. We describe our mission now as putting the power of digital making into the hands of people all over the world. With some deliberate choices there, right? Making. We believe the best way to learn about computers is by making stuff, right? Making websites, making robots, making LEDs, making lots of other things too. People, so we're predominantly about young people, but we also care about older people too. People need to have digital skills, whatever their age. And all over the world, Raspberry Pi is a global phenomenon. O'Clock is a global phenomenon. So while we're based in the UK, we care a lot about the UK, we think about all over the world. I mean, for me, this is why it's important. My kids are sat in the back, by the way. So this is Dylan and Bethan. Say hi, guys. Bethan has disappeared, so we like the cue. They're running digital making, right? And as a dad, I see the world through their eyes. It's really important, right, that kids grow up knowing how to navigate the digital world. It's important for work. It's important for problem solving. It's important just to be able to live and succeed and thrive in a world that's mediated by digital technology. Dylan got a Raspberry Pi in a sense hat and put it in the freezer. Bethan got a flotilla from Pimeroni, which is awesome if you haven't played with them. Made it go pink and said, let's have a party. Great things start with projects like that. So, we do three types of things in the foundation. Three things that we do to achieve that. First thing is, you know about this already, that's why you're here. We create low-cost, high-performance computers, and we try to give them to as many people as possible. Those of you who saw Evan's talk earlier, this year we've done some amazing things. So firstly, we achieved the goal of making a computer cheaper than the cables that you need to plug in. The Raspberry Pi Zero, which we gave away free on the cover of a magazine, we've now made computers so cheap that price isn't a barrier to people owning them. And we sold
8 million computers since we launched 4 years ago. And that deserves a win. Pi 3 launched, is it only a week ago? Is it only a week? Less than a week. Twice as fast, why can't we use it on board? It's completely awesome. But we don't just do hardware, and this is an important point. We also do free educational software. Sonic Pi, which again is a partnership with Computer Lab here and us, is about creating a platform which kids code and make music. Free educational software that plays on any platform but is best on a Raspberry Pi. Who knows this guy? This is Ben Nuttall. He's the great thinker in the foundation. Ben spent a long time thinking about abstraction. And he created a thing called GPIO0. What he's really done is found a way to make text-based programming super easy for young people to move from things like scratch and blocking to text-based programming. Ben's not in the room, but if you could all tell him, I had a photo. Apparently he gave a workshop earlier where his main point was that he's got more Twitter followers than me. I resist the temptation to ask you to unfollow him. I'm more generous than that. But the point is that we do hardware and we do free educational software. When you get a Raspberry Pi, you download the image, you get a huge amount of value in terms of educational content. And people do amazing things with Raspberry Pi computers. They solve real-world problems, and the blog that Liz curates is packed full of stories every week of people solving meaningful problems with these local computers. And people are also developing great products. NatureBytes has got this awesome nature camera, which, you know, should have had this data, and we get to play with it. So two other things we do as a foundation. Second is we make computing, we try to make computing digital making more relevant and accessible. From the ISS. And every time he gets one, he runs around the office going, I've got an email from the ISS. But we don't just do it for that. We do it because kids are engaged by space that might not think of the science is there. And it gives us a medium to talk about the fact that you're only able to go to space if you know how to program a computer. It's a huge, and that you, a child, can hold in your hand technology that enables people to go into space. And that's super cool, and it engages lots of kids. And we don't just do it on, oh, by the way, Evan showed a photo of you. And like wonderful, very flattering of him. So I thought I'd show you this one. So that's Evan with flat tin. Evan wants jet lag. He just got back from the States. I've got flat tin, take a photo. So he's not here, but Liz, you can tell him later. But we don't just use space, we also use weather, we use music, we use the arts, we use a whole range of different contexts to engage kids, predominantly kids in computer science. And in November last year, I did the thing which probably, if I do nothing else in this job, would have been the best move I made, which is I joined, with Claire, we joined forces between Code Club and Raspberry Pi Foundation. And this is the other part of this priority of ours, is we want to make it accessible. We want to create venues where kids, wherever they are in the world, can have a go at programming computers. And Code Club's like by far the biggest initiative on the planet, so it's awesome that they're now part of the foundation. Code Club's are after-school clubs for 9 to 11-year-olds. They're in the Beano, like another cool moment this year. It's like the Beano hands up, who is involved in Code Club or has volunteered at the Code Club or technical? Okay, so next year when I give a talk, when I say who's volunteered at the Code Club, every hand is going up. There's no excuse, right? It's the easiest way to make a massive contribution to the movement. We're like totally serious when Claire and I say we want a Code Club in every community on the planet. Like, that's not a joke, right? We want to do that. And we're thinking about what would the Code Club equivalent for teenagers be? And that's something we'll be talking about, I think, in the future. And the other thing we're doing at the foundation, and this is one of the things we want to do more of in the future, is figure out ways to support the community. So Raspberry Jams is like 375 of those registered on our website. We know that's the tip of the iceberg. We know that there's thousands of events happening all over the world, run by volunteers, that are all about education and sharing projects and like just doing cool things together. We've got a workshop coming up, I think, 3 o'clock, which is all about answering the question, what could the foundation do to help support the Raspberry Jam community more? How can we support each other? How can we grow this community? You'll hear me come back to that theme a lot.
So that's two things, right? Making low-cost hardware free education software. Second one, making more relevant and accessible. Third thing is about helping people learn about computing, how to make things with computers through training and through resources. This is kind of like our education effort. And if you know Carrie-Anne Philbin, she leads this work in the foundation. And one of the things we're doing is we're training educators. That's teachers, but not just teachers, also librarians and volunteers and so on. So I had the great privilege to be over in San Francisco with Matt and Courtney, who are back there, and lots of the education team, and we trained 40 educators from the US. They joined a group of 500 certified educators that we have now around the world. And I know many of them, not all of them, many of them are here this weekend. I want to shout out to those. Who's a certified educator in the room? I can see one. Okay, so what I see all the time is you guys and girls like going way beyond just bringing that stuff to the classroom, right? Coding evenings, resources you're creating, blogs you're writing, their CASMAS, the teachers, they're going on to support not only hundreds of thousands of kids in the classroom, but also lots of other educators as well. Essentially, our teacher training program, which is kind of led by James, who's out there, James, who leads that, is about building a community of educators. And this is one of my favorite photos from our blog from the whole of last year. So one of the other things James has been doing, because, you know, why wouldn't you, is helping teachers do high-altitude balloon launches so the kids can do that. Use a Raspberry Pi to take a photograph of the curvature of the Earth. Right? That's just awesome. So we've got like 24 launches planned over this period, I think. And again, it speaks to our ethos about education. We believe in project-based learning. We believe in being cross-curricular. We believe in doing cool projects that kids really challenge and really stretch them and teach them the concept. And then what we also do is we provide loads of resources and projects and share things that people can do, right? So you get a Raspberry Pi, one of the most common complaints I hear from people who just got myself, I don't know what to do. And so if you go to our, one way we do this is through the Magpie. Shout out the Magpie, because that was a huge community effort. They did house a year ago, 1 million downloads now. And that is 100 pages every month of community-generated projects of cool stuff to do with a Raspberry Pi. And I want to call out this lady here. So you know we did Zero. And you might all think that us in the foundation, we all had our zeros. We didn't, right? So there was a queue of foundation staff at WHSUS. I was the first. And I went in, and this woman was like, I was like, oh, hi, I've got Magpie. She was like, no, there were hundreds of boxes of magazines. We haven't opened them yet. And I was like, oh, okay. And I said, she said, why do you want? Why do you want? You're like the fourth person to ask. And I said, well, we're giving away a computer on the cover of the magazine. And this guy who worked at WH Smith overheard me and went, I'll find it! Hundreds of projects now. Things you can do with your Raspberry Pi, physical projects, all kinds of things that are different levels of competence. We're going to be doing more of this over the coming years. We're also trying to package it into a curriculum, some sort of way that you can follow your own interests and pathway through it. And what we also want to do is be much more open to projects from the community, whether in Code Club or whether in the Raspberry Pi community, people submitting what they're doing, then we'll kind of editorialize that. Sam will make great cartoons, and we'll kind of push those out so millions of people can use them. So that's kind of us, Dylan. You got a second one, dude. That's kind of us. That's what we're doing. That's the direction we're going in. That's what we're about. We also thought hard about what we stand for, right? And it's not what we stand for. It's what the community stands for. We're trying to understand that as best we can. So it's a very simple statement of what we think we stand for. Firstly, hands on. So we believe in project-based learning. We believe in making things. We believe that that's the best way to learn how to do something. Accessible to all. So 40% of the kids in Code Clubs are girls, and that's awesome. It's great to see so many young people, and young girls in particular, but also young boys, as part of this movement, right? We want to see that grow. We want to make sure that we're growing the community and making it more accessible all the time. We're cross-disciplinary. What that means is we think that computer science as a course is important, but actually, computing is just as relevant whether you're a biologist, or a geographer, a physicist, or whether you just want to hack about some stuff at home. And finally, we're community-led. So what we need is all the time is your input, your ideas, the things that you do turn into the programs that we run. And so all the time we're thinking about the community. Let me say a few words on the teeth, because they're awesome. I realised when I was doing this slide deck, I haven't got like a proper photo of the whole team together with code class and Raspberry Pi, which I haven't done it yet. But this is the foundation team, BET. We're pretty small. It's a mix of kind of educators and the bringing code class. We've got some community activists, people who know how to mobilise volunteers and so on. And life at the foundation is pretty interesting, right? So one day you will be running a workshop with dozens of teachers, pressing against the computers to see what you're doing, real interest. And the next day you'll be soldering Rachel's projects. Because Rachel at the foundation comes up with lots of projects that require us all to solder. We have an office in America. It's smaller than the office at Cambridge. 10 doubles up as a desk. But we're based in Cambridge, and we also have a little base in London where the Code Club staff have their headquarters, and we have people all over the UK, and now a team in San Francisco as well. What I think of the team is like, we're a small team, but we have this massive resource at our disposal, the volunteers, the community, the educators that we work with. But we're there to help you. So finally, and I'll end on this, and then hopefully we'll have some questions, or you can go for a coffee. Get involved, right? So, three ideas about how you can get involved. So firstly, like, share what you do. We're always inspired by what we read, but it's great when you see teachers blogging and sharing their resources. If you're writing a resource, use an open license, allow somebody else to use it too. Post a video on YouTube. Whatever it is that works for you, share what you're doing, share what you're learning with others. Secondly, support each other, right? And again, we see this in the community all the time. If somebody's struggling with a problem that you've solved, like, give them some advice, give them a hand. Go along to a Raspberry Jam, something like this, and get involved in the workshops and give, so share your knowledge and wisdom. And thirdly, volunteer. So, you should volunteer at Code Class. Like, you just should. You should also, if there isn't a jam in your area, you should set one up. Make a posse. Find three or four people, get together, find a room, if we can help you in whatever ways we can. Get some people together and do some stuff, right? If there's something happening in your area already, get involved. Code Adobe is a great initiative. They're always looking for volunteers to do their stuff. And the reason you should is this. That's what our educators. Because it's pretty cool, right? So, that was all I wanted to say. But I really want to get some... So does anyone want to say there's any awkward silences in the questions bit now, I'm just gonna put that. Okay. Over to you. Oh, we need, why didn't we get the audio with that? It's not perfect for children.
Small niche in your hardware ecosystem. And if I can ask you one thing, a little heartfelt plea, is would you consider starting a professional hardware development program? Because sometimes getting information about the nuts and bolts of Raspberry Pi Foundation products can be quite a torturous process. And I think if you had a professional hardware dev program, it would give you good results because your community would do some work and affect yourself.
That's a great idea. I'll take it back and chat with everyone about it. Thank you. What else? Where you get the gift? Oh, yeah. Hi.
One problem I've seen reported by various members of the community is there's a lot of education resources out there, both from yourselves and from others, but it's especially noticed with the stuff from yourself. Sometimes it just doesn't work anymore. There doesn't seem to be any process in place to check that the stuff still works with the foundation of pushing down changes periodically to their images. We have to move from Wheezy to Jesse.
Yeah.
And even when someone does report a problem, the bug reports often seem to go unanswered.
So we talk about this a lot. It's great. Thank you for raising this important point. things. So we have these resources that sit on our website, and for those of you who know, kind of they sit on GitHub and they're put into our website. And then when we change the operating system or the other software, we need when other people change theirs and we rely on that, then we have to incorporate those changes sometimes. And what we find most useful is when people do report. Right? So raising issues with us allows us to deal with it, allows us to spot it. And we're doing more and more in the team on kind of working on that and working through those issues and updating them. And so actually we are working. Yeah. What else?
You said that Raspberry Foundation just began something in the United States.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that the United States are a pretty big opportunity, but what about East? What about, I'm not talking about Russia or China, but what about East Europe?
So Germany, I prefer you, my friend here. So a couple of things to say. Firstly, we want over the coming years to figure out how we extend our charitable mission around the whole world, right? No question. America, we are making progress with, not least because we've got lots of team out there who are helping us. Interestingly, we know that 6.7 million people viewed our projects online, and we know that that was a genuinely global distribution, which is fantastic. So we know that some of the things we're doing are reaching globally. CodePlug, interestingly, is probably the most advanced thing that we've got in terms of our charitable programs that are working around the world. So CodePlug's in like 80 countries, and we're developing a model that allows nonprofits and charities in other countries to do a deal with us and license at very low cost access to the materials and so on. And that's working really well, and that is all over the world, including in the US. So it's something we're deeply committed to. We are still a small organisation, right? We've grown quite a bit. There's 47 people, I think, now in the foundation. But we're not quite big enough to take on the world on our own, so we're looking for partners the whole time. And of course, what we do have is great community members all over the world who are running things and doing great work, and one of the things we want to think about is how we support them better. But with France and Germany sat together.
Yeah.
This is like EU negotiations. Yeah, I've got 5 minutes left. So, yes.
Just on that point for three, there's two sessions going on around how we can grow both the jams and teacher training. So 3 o'clock in workshop one, and I'm not sure where else it is.
Workshop
five.
Thank you,
James.
I totally forgot to say that.
Yeah,
in an unfortunate clash of scheduling, we have to choose between education and community. What I would do is split between the two. So you can do it. What else? Yes.
Just curious, if I'm an Irish class school teacher, but if I really want to get behind my school and my school won't let me, but is there things the foundation can help us with? Because, you know, buying a set of highs or zeros, if we never get a set of zeros, that'd be a cheap way, but yeah. That's an issue. Is there a way the foundation can help schools to do that?
So the foundation doesn't donate equipment.
I
just want to kind of be clear about that. We don't do that because like we're not big enough, we don't be able to do a tiny slice of the school. And we do try to partner with people who have deep pockets than us. And there was a program with Google that ran a little while ago, which was pretty successful, I think. Our contribution to that really is we're trying to make the equipment low cost for everybody the whole time. Right? So we always have this choice between if we put the prices up a bit, get some more money into the foundation and redistribute that in some way. That's not what we're doing. What we're doing is trying to make the hardware as cheap as possible and the software.
Will we ever be able to buy 30 cents in this school?
We are producing them as fast as we can. We haven't talked about that earlier. I'm hopeful that soon you will be able to buy as many as you want. We're working all the time with all of our products relative to their performance to cheap and affordable. What else? Can you get the gift?
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you. don't like to allow people to come and give that for whatever reasons. So you really do need to talk to that look happening as well. Okay, so I'm going to answer your question.